Hello, I'm Sophia, and welcome to What We Need to Know About Ukraine. Here, I learn about Ukrainian history, literature, and culture, and share my findings with you. Today's episode is about Roksolana, the most powerful woman in the Ottoman Empire, who was also Ukrainian. This marvelous woman was born in a regular family in Ukraine, then enslaved as a girl, and after became the Ottoman Emperor's wife, all while significantly changing many traditions of the late Middle Ages Ottoman Empire. Roksolana is not Roksolana's real name. Her birth name was most likely Anastasia. Her last name was Lisovska. The name Roksolana comes from the name of a Scythian tribe, Roksolani, and they were last known to inhabit modern-day Ukraine. So that means that Roksolana was called in this way because she was from Ukraine, or at that time, Kievan Rus, Ruthenia. In Italy, she was known as La Rossa, the Ruthenian one, while in the Ottoman Empire, she was known as Hürrem Sultan, Hürrem being the first name that meant joyful or the laughing one. She was born in Rokhatyn, which is a small town in present-day Ivano-Frankivsk Oblast in western Ukraine, and her mother tongue was Ruthenian, which was a precursor to modern-day Ukrainian. Her father was a Christian priest, and Roksolana, at around the age of 10, which was from about 1515 to 1520, no one really knows what year exactly it was, she was captured by the Crimean Tatar raiders, who were hunting for Eastern European slaves. How exactly she was captured, it is not known, but at any rate, being captured at such an age, removed from her family, and being enslaved was certainly not easy. First Anastasia, soon to be known as Roksolana, was taken to Kaffa, modern-day Feodosia, Ukraine, in the Crimean Peninsula. There was a slave market there owned by the Ottoman Empire. She was then sold and exchanged multiple times before being brought to Constantinople. She was first owned by the Crimean Khan for around 4 to 5 years before he gifted her to his friend Suleiman, who was the son of the Sultan back then and would later become Suleiman I the Magnificent. At the time, she was just 15 years old. After this, she never returned to Ukraine. But what did connect her to Ukraine, if so, were the changes that she instituted in a different country, with a completely different view of this world. And this girl will go from being a slave to the most powerful person in the Ottoman Empire. But how will she do that? How can a slave marry a sultan? Before this, sultans married princesses from other royal families, noble and rich women, which would enhance their politics, as pretty much everywhere in the world. But Roksolana was a slave in the harem with hundreds of other women, most of whom never had a chance to even meet the Sultan. It is not known how she became noticed by the Sultan, or perhaps by his mother who was in charge of the harem. Her looks were viewed as exotic since she had red hair, pale skin, and Slavic features, which could have interested the Sultan or others, and yet later events will prove that the Sultan did not just love her for her looks. She was very willful and smart. All of these other women in the harem competed against Roksolana as well as against each other for being the Sultan's number one. By the time Roksolana had arrived to the harem, Sultan Suleiman already had a favorite, who was also his consort. Her name was Mahidavran, and she was a noble woman, and at that point she had already given Suleiman a son. Suleiman had 3 wives in total at the time, but it was Mahidavran that noticed that Roksolana was gaining Suleiman's attention, and grew really jealous that she attacked Roksolana by scratching her face and ripping out some of her hair. Roksolana was smart and she used this, and next time Suleiman called her, she refused to come because she said she could not let him see her in this appearance. Suleiman then questioned her, she told him what happened, and because of the incident, Suleiman punished Mahidevran and Roksolana became his favorite concubine. The word concubine means of lower status than his wives. At the time, the Sultan could not have a harem with hundreds of women, but also up to four wives, meaning that polygamous relationships were the norm of the Sultan, and I've already mentioned that he had three, but this was about to change. Suleiman the Magnificent became Sultan in 1520, meaning he became emperor, of course, which was around the same time that Roksolana became his concubine. A year later, they had a son, and in 1533, an astonishing event happened. Roksolana was freed from slavery by Suleiman the Magnificent for him to marry her. A Genoese ambassador wrote this in an undated letter. "This week, there has occurred in the city a most extraordinary event, one absolutely unprecedented in the history of the sultans. The grand singer Suleiman has taken himself as empress a slave woman from Ruthenia, called Roksolana." Roksolana broke many rules and traditions in the Ottoman Empire. That was not the only one. Despite the fact that Islamic law allowed the Sultan to take up to four wives and keep as many concubines as he pleased, as I've already mentioned, Suleiman the Magnificent remained true to Roksolana and spent time with no other women. Their relationship became monogamous. After the Sultan's mother's death, Roksolana was the second most powerful person in the empire, after her husband, of course. And she was the head of the harem, but it technically did not work the same as it used to, since the emperor no longer wanted the women there. Soon, Roksolana was able to convince her husband to move into the palace with him, and none of this was done in the Ottoman court before. Together, they had six children, which was also against the rules. Usually, the emperor would have only one son with a concubine or wife and then send her away to be with her son, teaching him how to do things and preparing him for potentially becoming an emperor. It was only if her son would actually become emperor that they would return to the palace. Other than that, they were not allowed to stay in the harem or at court. Also, they were not allowed to have more than one child or one son. So, in this case, Roksolana did stay and had five sons and one daughter with the emperor. She was also the first and only woman in the history of the Ottoman Empire who was awarded an official title. The Ukrainian girl was considered the Haseki Sultan, which meant that she was the co-ruler of the empire and Suleiman shared his power with her. This title was created just for her. It is said that during her time in power, she did everything possible to prevent the raids of the Crimean Tatars on her homeland, Ukraine. Roksolana was not just socially smart, but also very intelligent. She loved poetry, spoke multiple languages. Of course, she could read and write. She sang, she played on different instruments and danced, etc. She was also an incredibly good politician. She took control over affairs back home when her husband was away on military campaigns. It is not certain, but some think that Roksolana had the Grand Vizier killed because of his ambition and rivalry with her. She protected herself and her children from plotting and interests of the court. Roksolana is also considered to be masterful at intrigue. She achieved the fact that her son, Salim II, became the successor of the Sultan, since Suleiman I, most likely under heavy influence of Roksolana, ordered his eldest son, Mustafa, from his first wife to be killed for treason and encroachment on his father's rule, although he was his father's favorite child. A few weeks after, Mustafa's only child was killed as well, at just 7 years old, leaving Roksolana's children to be the only ones that are eligible for taking the throne. Although some Turkish historians say that it was Mustafa's own fault and character that killed him. Nonetheless, Selim II, Roksolana's son, became emperor after his parents' death. His nickname was a drunk, but he actually wasn't one. All he did to get this nickname was legalize the sale of wine in the Ottoman Empire. In fact, he was a smart ruler and did good things for the empire, for example, the burning down of Moscow. Roksolana was also free to preside over infrastructure works in the city, such as the creation of public drinking and bathing facilities, charitable projects, such as the establishment of soup kitchens for the poor, and religious works, like building of mosques and hostels for pilgrims. Roksolana was also a patron for the arts. Many thought that Roksolana used magic, since Suleiman liked her so much. That was not the case, of course, and their correspondence has a lot of ardent love letters, and it is clear to see that they really did love each other very much. Many of these letters have been saved, so I will read a few quotes. Roksolana writes, quote, "My Sultan, what an infinite and burning pain of parting. Save me, I who is so unhappy, and do not withhold your beautiful letters. Let my soul receive at least a drop of joy from your messages. When they are read to us, your servant and son Mehmed, and your slave and your daughter Megrima are weeping for you. Their tears drive me mad." End quote. And Suleiman the Magnificent replies, quote, "My dear goddess, my amazing beauty, the mistress of my heart, my brightest moon, the companion of my deep desires, my only one, you are dearer to me than all the beauties of the world." End of quote. Even after her death, Roksolana changed the future of the Ottoman Empire. She died in 1588, and 8 years later, the Sultan himself died and was buried next to her. And, of course, this never happened before. During those 8 years, he did not have any other wives or women. Roksolana, a Ukrainian girl, Anastasia Litovska, also started the century known as the Sultanate of Women, meaning that wives and mothers wielded power via political influence over their royal men. And that does make sense, since Roksolana had influence over all the actions Suleiman I did politically, etc. Many authors wrote books and poetry about the Empress, even hundreds of years after. People painted her, wrote songs about her, they wrote operas and made movies and TV shows. Many great composers devoted music to Roksolana, and one of them was one of the greatest classical composers in the world, the father of symphony, the Austrian composer Joseph Haydn. It was his symphony La Roxelane that he dedicated to Roksolana that you heard throughout this episode. Undoubtedly, Roksolana was helped by beauty, cunning, cruelty, and a remarkable mind. And of course, her heart and her personality. She personally corresponded with the rulers of neighboring states, Poland, and let's remember that at this time Ukraine was under the Kingdom of Poland, as well as Venice and Persia, etc. She knew the court perfectly and took care of the arts, and of course, she loved Suleiman I and he loved her. She had a real political influence. A most powerful woman, she brought some Ukrainian traditions and implemented them at court in the Ottoman Empire. A person who has gone from being kidnapped and enslaved in a different country at 10 years old did not break down, but instead was known as the Laughing One, the Ukrainian One, and became one of the most powerful rulers of the Ottoman Empire.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining me today, and this was What We Need to Know About Ukraine This Week.